I'd like to get on to our next speaker, if that's possible. And that's going to be Dr. Jeff Sosman, who's one of this country's best known melanoma medical oncologists, and really brought a wealth of knowledge and clinical experience back to Northwestern when he joined us just a few years ago. So Jeff, I'm going to turn this over to you. And Jeff's going to talk about what are the options for stage four melanoma, which several people have asked about, and when is a clinical trial the right option for me? So Jeff,
please. Sure, thanks, Jeff, for the nice introduction. And Sam, it's just great that you hold events like this and really give patients a chance to hear about what's going on in melanoma therapy. I'll share my screen. Okay, so I'm gonna cover two topics. One being, treatment options in metastatic melanoma, and the other are clinical trials, and they certainly weave together. I've been in this field for a long time, and treatment options was quite a short talk in the past. But you'll see it's really changed in these past 5 to 10 years. Okay, to move it forward. Okay. So for all those patients who've not had prior therapy, so we call that treatment naive for metastatic cancer, as Carl and Jeff both may have mentioned, surgery still plays a role. And I think most of us treat patients who've had an isolated recurrence after a prolonged period of time, especially those with skin, lymph node, lung, adrenal cancer, and even others, are really resected or are removed surgically. And some of the patients certainly do very well over a long time. And so that is still potentially the treatment of choice. I think in terms of most patients who get systemic therapy, I don't fill that description. There are really a few treatments. First of all, single agent therapy with an anti-PD-1 agent, which I'll talk about more, which is pembrolizumab, Keytruda, and nivolumab, Opdivo. I think both are equivalent, and both in terms of toxicity and benefit. And certainly, this is certainly a treatment option for all patients. One of the other options is a combination of nivolumab with ipilimumab or Yervoy, and that can even be given at different doses of ipilimumab. In terms of the dose of nivolumab actually probably doesn't matter because the toxicity isn't changed or the benefit. However, the dose of ipilimumab makes a big difference in toxicity. And certainly there's people who do either, and it's not clear which is the best, but certainly 3 milligrams is the one that most people are comfortable with. There are other treatments, maybe first line is not the right way to look at these, but there's still tumor infiltrating lymphocytes, and a company who's worked on it quite intensely and may even have an FDA approved product. And then interleukin, which is still around, and I'm sure some of you who've been around for a while may have even received it, but it is certainly not used in the front line in anyone. Now, there's also patients who have BRAF mutated cancer. And this opens them to other therapy. And this is about 40 to 50% of patients. And they can be treated with combinations of BRAF inhibitors and MEK inhibitors. And there's actually three doublets. And I'll talk a little bit about the doublets, but all of them mechanistically are different. Efficacy, it's not clear. And probably the important thing is the toxicities are different. And most recently, there's been approval of a combination of one of the combos, vemurafenib and cobimetinib, and an anti-PD-L1 agent that's been approved in lung cancer, but not in melanoma. So let's just talk about targeting the BRAF mutation. And as I said about 40% of patients, 50, have this mutation in the tumor. It's a mutation that drives their cancer. And we have these drugs, one that actually directly blocks the function of that altered molecule. And then below that, we're able to inhibit another enzyme that is part of the same pathway. And that certainly has been effective therapy. And you can see, though people don't really appreciate this, this is a large group of patients who've gotten one of the combination, and looking at all of the patients, and you can see the median survival is over 2 years, which is a huge difference than what we used to see. And you can see there's certainly patients who are alive at 3 and 4 years. And this is the more recent combination, the encorafenib or Raftobi and binimetinib or Mektobi. And really it's the upper line I want you to look at. The lower line is bemurafenib alone, which certainly is not given at all. But you can see the survival in this group is even better, that probably the median is somewhere around 33 months, though that is really a matter of how the curve bends. But even at 3 years, 47% are still alive. And one of the things that is true everywhere in metastatic melanoma is there are features that are good prognostic factors and bad prognostic factors. And you'll see we look a lot at the LDH, an enzyme that is not really of great interest on its own mechanism, but it isn't a factor that represents the speed at which a tumor is growing or how much tumor. And the number of disease sites, different organs involved, and certainly important to everyone is how healthy the patient is. Are they doing all the normal activities, or are they symptomatic from their cancer? And you can see of those lines that patients who have none of these poor prognostic factors, you know, have a much better outcome. And at 3 years, these patients are about 75% are still alive, while a patient who has all of those bad factors, this isn't letting me touch the screen, you can see the 24-month survival is quite small. So when we talk about efficacy, you always have to remember the patient's overall prognosis, and it has a huge impact on survival. So all of these have similar outcomes. It does look like the encorafenib and binimetinib may be better, but they've never been compared, and certainly the difference may be negligible. But you can see they all have freedom from progression for anywhere from a year to a year and a quarter, and the median survival is about 2 years to 2.75 years. And so, as I said, the benefit is very similar. The toxicities are different. With encorafenib, you do see some liver toxicity. You see some nausea and vomiting, sometimes hypertension. In dabrafenib and trametinib, you see fevers that can be a real problem for management. And then the vemurafenib and cobimetinib lead the vemurafenib to intense photosensitivity. And you really need to be careful with UV light at all. And so because of the latter two, I tend to use the encorafenib, binimetinib, but all of them are effective. And sometimes you have to start with one and move to the other based on side effects. So let's just talk about the immune response. And basically, there are a set of cells important. And these cells actually, the MDSC, the tumor-associated macrophage, and Treg, are actually immune suppressor cells. And you can see the tumor really causes infiltration. And the blue are T cells, and the actual gold, I guess is what I describe, are natural killer cells. So this is kind of the yin and yang of tumor cells. We have infiltration of good cells and bad cells. Now, we also know that there are molecules on the left that affect the way the T cell works. And you can see the T cell actually has a number of molecules that actually activate it, as well as a number of molecules that actually inhibit it. And the two that you'll all recognize are CTLA-4 and PD-1. So because they inhibit the effect of T cells by blocking them, they can release the T cells from these breaks. And it's the opposite on the other side. So this is just a large illustration that shows that when these inhibitors bind to their ligand or the protein on the T cell, they block it. But if you put an antibody like anti-CTLA-4, anti-PD-1, you can prevent that interaction. And a lot of things you might hear is an inflamed or a non-inflamed tumor, a hot tumor and a cold tumor. And I think really what that means is that there are a lot of these immune cells on the inflamed tumor, and the non-inflamed tumor doesn't. And this is kind of a illustration of the inflamed tumor where you see lots of immune cells, the tumor on the left where there are no immune cells, and the tumor in the middle where the immune cells just can't get in. So to look at what are the results with these drugs, I've already told you pembrolizumab is compared to ipilimumab in this study. And you can see that in this study, pembrolizumab has a median survival of 38 or 39 months. And at 5 years, you're still seeing a fair number of patients, 43%, who are still alive, which is almost in the past so rare, but we're seeing almost half the patients. And the other thing that I think a lot of doctors and patients may not realize is that when you can stop the drugs, when and how is not clear, But this is the results of patients who got treated for 2 years. Then they stopped the pembrolizumab. And in the blue line are those who had complete remission. And at a year and a half, only 4% had recurred. And if they have a partial remission, only 8% recurred. And actually, even those with stable disease, only a third had recurred. So clearly, 2 years and stopping can give you a really still an excellent result. The other treatment I've mentioned is the combination of ipilimumab and a drug like nivolumab or pembrolizumab. And the ipi works in the lymph nodes area where T cell is induced to activate. And really when it comes to the tumor is when the tumor is meant to kill the T cell is meant to kill the tumor. And these checkpoints block that. And these checkpoint antibodies are what overcomes both of the inhibition. And this is a slide that shows the combination of nivolumab and ipilimumab at 5 years. And you can see on the, I think it's the left side, could be your right side, that progression-free survival in that group of patients is a third of patients at 5 years have never progressed. And on the other side, there's the overall survival. And again, over a half have stayed alive up to 5 years. Now you'll see there's two lines that are relatively close together, the green and blue. The blue is slightly below, but that represents the combination versus the nivolumab alone. And you can judge yourself, is that enough of a difference to tolerate the toxicity that Dr. Chandra will talk about. So this is a very popular figure showing how we've added one by one. This is sort of slanted in a way, but it's true that we started with chemotherapy and saw a survival of 6 to 9 months. Targeted therapy has made a difference, and probably it's a little unfair the way they show this. And ipilimumab, you can see there is a tail. PD-1, nivolumab or pembro, a same tail but higher up, and then potentially the combination. I think this over-exaggerates the difference of the combination. One of the important things are these three factors and how to select patients for which treatment. And basically the question now lies in how do we improve this? So these are not standard. Vaccines, use of some of the other co-stimulatory or inhibitory checkpoints. If you remember, there are both of those. One approach is injecting the tumor directly, and probably alone, it's not a real effective therapy. But when it's combined with one of those checkpoints, it can really improve the overall outcome, or at least it seems. Radiation therapy has become of great interest, whether if you radiate one area, it can enhance the effect of the PD-1 somewhere else. And then adoptive therapy, TIL cells, and now we are looking at cells that actually react just to the specific antigen on the T cells. And I showed you before, there are factors that can patient selection. And all of these factors give you an idea of what you can look at to get a sense of who is more likely and less likely to respond. everyone still may respond, but maybe we should target our treatment improvements to those who are more likely. So overall, as I said, BRAF therapy, there are three regimens. The outcome is really dependent on the prognostic factors. And now there is some investigation in the combination. Immune checkpoint inhibitors, really, we're talking about a single agent or a combination. And as I said, using these in conjunction with BRAF-targeted therapy is certainly one of the more recently approved.